Hey, it's Professor Dave. Let's talk about organocuprates.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So organocuprates are organic compounds involving copper. So that qualifies them as organometallic reagents, just like Grignard reagents, and also the organolithium reagents that we looked at just before this. And in fact, they are prepared from organolithium reagents. So say we have two equivalents of this N-butyl lithium, and we're going to react with copper bromide. And what we're going to end up with here is we've got this copper anion with both of the alkyl groups attached to it. So we've got those two butyl groups right here, and then that lithium counterion is going to hang out near the copper anion, and we also get LIBR. So this is a little bit different from the way we prepare both Grignard and organolithium. In fact, we need to do this, it's called transmetallation, because copper doesn't insert itself into these, it doesn't do the kind of chemistry that lithium and magnesium do. So we have to use something else first. So the whole thing, if we wanted to start from an alkyl halide, remember we could do what we learned before, reacting the alkyl halide with lithium, we get the organolithium reagent, and then as we just said, reacting with copper bromide is going to give us our organocuprate, also known as a Gilman reagent. And so this is the way we're going to see it typically if we're just, it's written out on a test or something. We're going to see R2CuLi. And we need to know what that means. We need to know that copper is the central atom there, and that it bears a formal negative charge. That's very important in terms of what that reagent will do. It's got the two alkyl groups, whatever they are, R can be anything, projecting from that copper anion, and then lithium serves simply as a counterion. That's a positive counterion there. So that's how we're going to make these organocuprates. So what are some things that organocuprates do? So the most common application for organocuprates is as follows. Say we have this one here where the alkyl groups are methyl groups. Now, what we can do, we have this carbonyl-containing compounds, and we saw that Grignard reagents like to attack carbonyls. We saw that organolithium reagents like to attack carbonyls. But instead, organocuprates are going to do something slightly different. These are not as reactive, right? Organolithium compounds are extremely reactive, but these are much less so. These are a bit softer. And what they're going to do is they're actually going to attack the beta position when we have an alpha-beta unsaturated ketone. So here's alpha, here's beta. This is very similar to when we learned Michael addition. We saw that an enolate would attack the beta position of an alpha-beta unsaturated ketone in a very similar way. What's going to happen is this methyl group, it's basically a methanide. We've got CH3- attacking there. And the reason that that is favorable is because the copper is negatively charged. If this carbon leaves with both of the electrons in that bond, that neutralizes the copper atom. So that's actually favorable. So we're going to push that here. And then we're going to push this pi bond up here, and then we're going to push that pi bond up there. So it may seem a little strange. If you watched the Michael addition tutorial, then it might make sense. But at first glance, we may not see exactly why this could be an electrophilic site. But don't forget that resonance is involved here, right? We can draw another resonance structure, or we could, with this pi bond up here and this pi bond up here. It wouldn't be as strongly contributing because we'd have a formal negative and positive charge. But nevertheless, it is a valid resonance structure. So there is one resonance structure where there's a formal positive charge here. That means on the composite, there still is some electron deficiency at that site right there. So that explains why that's the site of attack for this compound. So the methanide is going to attack here, kick that pi bond up there, kick that pi bond up there, and here we are. And so certainly the lithium counterion is going to hang out by the oxyanion. But then all we need is some aqueous acidic workup. We're going to reform the carbonyl. We're going to do that. You could also protonate right there, but then, of course, that would tautomerize, right? We know that enols quickly tautomerize to ketones, typically. So, but here, mechanistically, we could just reform the carbonyl, kick that up, grab the proton, and we've got our ketone. So notice that the alpha-beta unsaturation is gone, right? That's not there any longer. But what we have done is we have attached this alkyl group. In this case, it was a methyl group, but it could have been any alkyl group, including a very long alkyl fragment. So this is a great synthetic technique when we are trying to attach a large portion of a molecule specifically at the position that is beta to a carbonyl, right? All we need is that alpha beta degree of unsaturation, and we are going to be very certain that we are going to be able to attach that at that precise position. So if that is part of your synthetic strategy, this is a very useful technique that you can employ, and that is also the primary purpose of using organocuprates, that is this conjugate addition, right? It's a 1-4 addition rather than 1-2 with Grignard or organolithium that would attack right there, right? Also just to mention one alternate application here, we can do simple SN2. We can have the alkyl group attack here and just displace the halogen and just attach that alkyl group on there just to make a longer alkyl chain. So this is just a very simple SN2 on an alkyl halide, but once again, this is the primary application, this kind of conjugate addition on some carbonyl-containing compound with an alpha-beta degree of unsaturation. So that's a little bit about organocuprates or Gilman reagents. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.